following interview was conducted with Marion Blalock for the Purdue University Law History Program. It took place on Wednesday, July 25th, 2007, in the Dean's Conference Room at Stewart Center. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Law History Librarian. This is part two. Welcome. Want to pick up on a little bit more, tell anything further on the Minority Engineering Program. I know you did address some of the challenges, but some of the changes that even are still in place, and you're involved in it, even though you're now part-time.
Well, I don't remember exactly what I told you about last time as far as that's concerned. Okay. I did start working with the program in 1975 under Dr. Harold M. Ryan, and as a consequence, we were involved with some national grants, like the Sloan Foundation grant, that helped us to get started with our summer programs, particularly with students in the eighth grade and within the state of Indiana. So we really started our summer programs full-fledged with that program, and we included teachers and counselors in that. Eventually broke off with including teachers and counselors and only had the children in the summer, but would do something separate with the teachers as a teacher-counselor workshop, and that worked out better for us. And we used those people as sort of our disciples to continue to identify potentially qualified children that we could include year after year. As time went on, other corporations and governmental agencies began to put challenge grants out there, and one was called from the Department of Energy, and it was called Preface, and we used that to springboard from the eighth grade program and invite those children back after they'd completed the ninth and tenth grade. So we call that the Preface program. When that grant ran out, we were able to get industry to begin funding that. And then we had a program called Minority Introduction to Engineering that actually started in 1975, the summer before I came. It was a national program and was originated at the University of Illinois, but became national around the country. And several companies were funding that program, and they were funding every dime of it, including the children's travel, their food, their room and board, and everything. And so that was very, very successful for us, because we would start with the students in the eighth grade. We would do things to get them interested in engineering, make them aware of engineering, then encourage them to go back home and, you know, take the right courses in math and science and what have you, and make really good grades, and then promise them that they would be invited back to the next level of the program. And so that was sort of an incentive. And then after they'd finished with the ninth and tenth grade, they'd get invited back for the two-week night program, which was an incentive. And then from there, we would recruit them, and we would offer scholarships. So we had pretty much a systemic approach to what we were doing, which made it quite successful for us. Every school didn't do the same thing. Each school had to do what they needed to do. And one of the premises was that you had to find a student to match the student with the institution. And so it made no sense for every school to do the same identical thing anyway. But what we did work for us, and we were able to get students from not only Indiana, but we used to get more students from the University of, from the city of Chicago than the University of Illinois was able to do. At one point, and I believe it was in 1990 maybe, we had gotten up to 450 some minority students enrolled in the schools of engineering at Purdue University, and I could give you a name for every last one of those students. And they were all African American, Mexican American, Puerto Rican, and Native American Indian. And we could identify every last one of those students, so we were doing quite good. Around about the mid-90s, things started to take a turn downward, and part of that was from policies that Purdue had established, like beginning to start an admissions fee. I think I talked to that about that the last time, and I'm not sure that we've ever recovered from that admissions fee thing in terms of bringing in any significant numbers of minority students that are of the four ethnic groups that I've already mentioned.
How did you recruit? How did you get the students to come? What was the recruitment? Did you contact the schools or?
Oh, we used all kinds of methods. Okay. One was those summer programs. The other was we would buy the College Board search lists, and we would have specific criteria that we would use. You'd have to have a certain SAT score. We'd choose particular states that we would try to draw from. You had to have an interest in certain types of potential college majors. And we would purchase those lists, and we would invite students to a variety of different programs that we hosted, because we not only hosted the summer programs, but we would have programs in the during the year round. In the fall, we had a program, or still have a program, called Promise. And that was Purdue's recruitment of minorities interested in the schools of engineering. I was really good at those little acronym things. And so they'd come for a 2.5-day program. And typically those were students that were left over from that college search board list when too many people applied, and we had to turn them down. We would promise to invite them for the promise program in the fall. And then during the fall semester, you know, people would apply for admission. And so once we got all the admissions people applied for, in the spring we had a program called Engineering Preview. So every student that had been offered admission to Purdue School of Engineering,
a full-time student,
they'd been offered admission, they'd probably been offered admission somewhere else as well. We would have them come back in the spring before they had to make their final selection. And we call that Engineering Preview. And that's when we really went in for the kill, trying to really convince them to come here. And we would have a parent session so that the parents felt like they were part of the whole process as well. And that program was quite successful for us as well, because about 95% of the students that would come to the preview program actually matriculated and came in the fall. Mm-hmm. So those kinds of systemic approaches to the recruitment was what made our programs so successful. And many, many schools benchmark themselves after our programs as a result. I don't know if I mentioned to you, the last time that we started an organization called the National Association of Minority Engineering Program Administrators, and that consisted of people all around the country that ran programs similar to this. And we used that as, one, to support each other, two, to share and benchmark with each other, and to have our industrial friends who were funding our programs come and, you know, see some of the things that we could showcase, highlight, and see ways that we would work together. And we had a lot of partnerships going on as a result of that. I was one of the founding members of that organization, and then I became the president. I was the second president, the national president of it. Since that time, the organization still exists, but it's very, very different than it was then, because all the programs that were going on back then, full-fledged, they've pretty much dwindled. They've been absorbed into the university, and we've just lost a lot of focus, and I don't think that we're doing the kind of work that we used to do in the late 70s, definitely all of the 80s and most of the 90s. I think we've lost that flavor. We've called it diversity now, which has really been more of a diversion for us, because it's not really focused on the particular things that we needed to do in order to recruit those specific targeted populations of students. And so we've got a different kind of kid that comes here now. And they're usually well-to-do children, and they don't...
How did you happen to decide to start with the 8th grade? Did that's really...
Dr. Emmerich came up with that.
The 8th would be a good...
Yes, because the American Society of Engineering Education had been doing studies, and they said that an engineer is started around the 8th grade, because that's when you really start getting trapped in the mathematics. Mm-hmm. And that's when we started. That's why we started, just because of the ASWE studies. And Dr. Emmerich put that in there. Well, as time went on, we found that students were being introduced and tracked in their math even earlier. That's why we now do 6th, 7th, and 8th graders.
So you backed up.
Yeah, we backed up because we saw what was going on there.
That went in the schools.
Mm-hmm. Right. Now, this past 2 years, since I'm no longer the director of the Minority Engineering Program, there's not been very much of an effort to get raise funds for those programs. And last summer and this summer, it was quite a struggle. And so this summer I had to cut back significantly the number of students that I could invite, because I didn't have the money and the university didn't feel that they needed to be funding that as one of their top priorities. So we only had like 20-some students in each of the programs this year. And we combined the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade programs, which I knew was be a disaster. And it really wasn't a disaster, but it was really not a good thing to do. There's a world of difference between 8th graders and 7th graders. And then you add 6th graders into that, that's just not a good match. So the priorities are now different. The buzzwords are different. Diversity is a new buzzword, and so you can do anything with that. In fact, when I'm sitting in a meeting and somebody says we're going to talk about diversity, I ask them to define it first. Because every meeting I go to, diversity means something different to somebody. And so you have to know what you're talking about before you can have a meaningful conversation. So anyway, the effort is, you know, it's just hanging by a thread these days.
Did you get, were there a lot from Indiana, Midwest, did you sort of centralize in the Midwest for these programs to the students?
In fact, we used to get a ton of kids from Puerto Rico, because I visited over there a couple of times. And once you got a couple of them, they just started coming in droves. And that seems to have dwindled significantly as well, because nobody really goes over there and really recruits anymore. We used to get a lot of them from California, all over the country, actually. We were doing pretty good, but mostly the Midwest, primarily.
But
most often not in Illinois.
But other schools were doing similar programs,
yeah.
And that's what the association sort of, you know, kind of was a little bit of cohesiveness, so you could kind of share.
Yeah, because, you know, they may have summer programs, and they might have a kid that just really wasn't cut out to be at their institution, but they might share with one of the rest of us and say, hey, you might want to look at XYZ. He lives in your state, and maybe, you know, you guys have the particular discipline that they're interested in. For example, we didn't have oceanography or things like that. And some kids would want to major in something like that. Well, then you want to go to the schools that offer things.
We have that.
Yeah. And so we had a really good relationship
sure.
in that respect. And we were all very, very close and good friends. And we had tons of industry people that were very close and good friends with us. And they funded all of our programs. So the universities got off real cheap. They hardly paid anything other than our salary and the little sparse space we got. But the industry people paid for our scholarships. They paid for all of our little programs that we would do. And we weren't really getting any money from our institutions to do these things.
What's your follow-up when the students graduate? Have you kept in touch with them?
Oh, yeah. We have, actually, we have an organization called the Purdue Alumni, Purdue Black Alumni Organization.
For alumni from all the schools?
Not all of the schools. But for the past 7 or so years, it was run by one of our engineering alums. And so the majority of the people that come back are either the people that graduated back in the late 60s, early 70s, and then a lot of the engineering students. Because that's who graduated from here is a lot, mostly engineering students. We had more students graduating out of engineering, I'm sure, than any of the other disciplines.
And is that an ongoing organization that's
oh, yes.
here?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean,
is it
a national one?
No,
it's
no.
Purdue Black Alumni Organization.
Okay.
And
okay.
yes, it's for national, everywhere they are. And so whatever the lists that have been compiled over the years, Tony Zamora, who used to direct the Black Cultural Center, hired some of his students to go and actually go through the library and look at every last one of the debris and get the names of all the black people out of those. And that's how we started one of the lists. And then I used to keep all of our students' names and addresses,
yeah,
and so we'd add on to that. And then different people added on to the list, and that's how. And then alums start to tell you about other people that they remember, and that's how we got our list together for the Purdue Black Alumni Organization. And so it's doing very well right now.
When do you usually meet? Once a year?
Generally at homecoming.
Yeah. So it'll be coming this fall, right?
Right.
That's really one other thing on that program. Would the other schools have similar ones? The engineering was there any similarities among any of the other schools on campus and have?
After a while, science, I think, was the next school. Pharmacy, actually, was the school that really tried to do something early on.
Before engineering did? Or
no,
or
probably
about the same?
Around the same time.
Okay.
Engineering and pharmacy and science kind of tried to do some things together. Pharmacies didn't really take off the way we thought it was going to. The young man that was running it at the time, he was quite assertive and aggressive, and he was really doing a pretty good job. His last name was Weaver. Dick Weaver, I think, was his name. And then they've had several different directors since then. Science then started a program, and then technology eventually started a program, and we, you know, shared all of our information with all of them, and they took some of our ideas and used them, and some they didn't. And so. We really were the foundation of the effort
yeah.
here at Purdue, the engineering schools.
And you so, just got the ball and you ran with it.
Well, actually, I believe Harold Amrine should be given the majority of the credit. Certainly, Bill LeBeau was heavily involved in it. Arthur Bond had some involvement with it. Dr. Sawley Taylor, who was here as a visiting professor the first year that they started writing the grant. So I don't, you know, I didn't start it. I got hired in it, and I thought I'd be in it for 2 years, and then I was going to be gone, and the next thing I knew, it was 30-some years. And I was really passionate about it. I really believed in it, and it felt really good to see that you could have an impact on a young person's life, and now I see them coming back. We had several alums whose children were in the program this summer, so that's always kind of like, you know, whoa, nostalgia, and oh, have I gotten that old, that kind of thing. And so, we've had a number of children that belong to kids that I had recruited in these pre-college programs that actually went to Purdue, graduated in engineering, and now are bringing their children
right.
back.
What you're saying is,
recycled the love and the learning.
Right. Professor Barney has experienced the same thing because with his day on campus,
mm-hmm.
and now being a fact fellow, sometimes when we're over there, the fathers are bringing the students back, and they
yeah.
say, and it's hard to remember. pretty narrow. But they were, because you're one of, see, you're one of many. I mean, when he stands up, they remember him, but it's hard to remember all the people, but it's nice.
But it's amazing that I've remembered so many of them.
That's
I won't
great.
Remember their names, and they, but then they say, you don't remember my name. And then I go and tell them something about themselves, and they say, God, you got to remember it. Yeah, I just don't remember your name, but I remember your behavior.
Something sticks in my mind, right?
Right.
Well, that leads to you were going to make some comment about this, some of the boards and things that you were on, too.
Oh, one of the
and
important
was
boards.
Your funding people that supported it.
One of the boards that was very important, and it still exists, and once again, none of these efforts are as strong as they once were, but the National Action Council for Minorities in Engineering. And that actually consisted principally of CEOs of major Fortune 500 companies. After a couple of years, after we had started the NAMIPA organization, the one I mentioned before that consists of people that did jobs like mine, one of our advocates in our group, he was a much older man, and he worked at Caltech, and he advocated for us to have a seat on that board because we were the ones that were out in the field doing the work, and they were the ones with the money, and they needed to know what we knew and vice versa. So he advocated for us to have a spot on that board, and before we became a full-fledged organization, he was then representing us on that board. And then after we became a full-fledged organization, our first president represented them. And then after, and the way it was supposed to be is each president of NAMIPA would have a spot on the NACME board of directors. Well, I was the second president, so I got on. Well, at that time, that board decided that they were in charge of who sits on their board, and they decided they didn't want to have this switching every year. And so they decided that whoever was on their board would have a 3-year term and then would be up for renewal. Well, it ends up that was during my tenure, and that was started in 1983. And so I was on that board for, what, approximately 9 years, 10 years, something like that, because I kept getting renewed. And I was the only female on there for probably 7 of those years. And they finally put the president of one of the Texas universities on. Her name escapes me at the moment, but she was the first university female president that was on it. And then before I got off the board, they put a woman on it from AT&T, but they did not have any women. And every year I would tell them, I said, you know, I really enjoyed being with you guys, but it would be nice to have some females on this board. And they would chuckle, oh, help us to find some. And I'm thinking, you've got all these women that work for you. You don't have to help you find somebody. Get out of here. So that was interesting because...
tell us what some of the...
The board members, I really actually sat on the board when the president of IBM was on there, when Jack Welch was the president of General Electric, Exxon and Mobil, and International Paper Company. I actually met some of the big, big wigs back then, and I was the only low-level person on the board. There were a couple of other colleges represented, like the president of MIT, and the president of New Jersey Institute of Technology, and one other institution. But their presidents were represented, but our president wasn't, but I was. And so that's, and I would get to see all the budgets. I mean, it was tons of money and stuff. And I went through four executive directors of that organization. So I was on the board through four executive directors. And it got to the point where this one guy started bringing on vice presidents. Well, vice presidents and CEOs don't sit on the same board, so CEOs stopped coming. And so a lot of vice presidents started making up that board. I don't think they have any CEOs anymore that are on that board of directors. And it's not as strong of an organization as it once was. And they don't, there's not a lot of money there anymore. But we have even written grants and gotten grants. Purdue, our program, got grants from them to do some programs because the money was there. And they would have challenge grants that would operate. And that was a fascinating experience. And then that board of... The reason I was on the board of trustees for St. Mary the Woods College, the oldest all-female college in the country, was because President Diskey was having lunch with the president of that institution or at a meeting or something, and he called me on his cell phone and asked if I'd be interested in interviewing to be on their board. And I just said, well, why not? You know? So I drove down and I got to meet Sister Doherty and was interviewed and got to meet some of her other people. And then next thing you know, I was on that board, and I ended up doing 9 years on that board because you could only do so many stints, and I did all of them. So that was fun, and I was glad he did that. It was a nice experience. I hated Terre Haute, Indiana. I hated driving there passionately. But when I get on that campus, I just felt so at peace. It was a really pretty campus, not extremely big, but it always looked like nobody was there. But it was very pretty, and I learned a lot of things about Catholicism as a result of that. And I felt I was able to make some contributions. I was on that board with Josie George, you know, the racing thing. And one year we went on a special trip where the board went to Florida, and the older George, Mrs. George, owned all kinds of land down there and a country club, and she had us out at this country club.
This is the George family from the Indy 500.
Yeah.
And they support...
Yes, oh, God, you think it belongs to them. St. Mary of the Woods, it's, you know, they put a lot of money into that school.
That's what I've heard.
So we were down there, and in fact, they were one of the first people, schools, to get a grant from Eli Lilly for this huge retention thing that we now have a grant for.
Sure.
And when they first started writing the grant here, I was able to share with them some of the work that St. Mary of the Woods did to go into the grant that they wrote to get funded. So, you know,
that was nice. You've got a great resource. Were there any other people?
But, you know, I don't think anybody ever pays any attention to that.
Any other people from the state that were on that board at the same time? Did you get to know them?
Oh, yeah, there were
some women and men and women.
Oh, yeah, there were women and alums. There were a lot of alums from there, the women, and they even had their husbands would be part of the board. And so it's a small private college, so, you know, you could get away with doing all that. So,
yeah.
I don't know anybody that... Well, the one woman, Carter, that used to be Attorney General of the state, black female, she was on there my last year, so I got to meet her through that. Other people, they weren't really people that I think are really super well-known.
Some from out of state, I imagine.
What?
They have alums and things of that sort.
Yeah.
Okay. How about the alumni? Were you ever active in the Alumni Association at all?
Oh, yeah, I was one of the... Telling people to help with getting that started. I mean, Tony's more after the 10-year anniversary of the Black Cultural Center, which was one of those things that in 1968 we had marched for when I was an undergraduate student, and all of those things came about after we graduated. But Tony Zamora was trying to do the 10-year anniversary, and as a consequence, after he had those students go through all of those books, and find all the Black people in there and get their names, started writing and inviting them back for this 10th anniversary thing.
For the Black Cultural Center?
Mm-hmm. In fact, Dr. Fred Hubley even came to one of the luncheons, and he made a comment that I thought was quite interesting. He said, back when I was president, we didn't see all these beautiful Black women that we can look at today on the campus, and look at what we have now. So that was really interesting. But that's really kind of how it got started. And from that springboard and a group that started exploring starting an organization, and I was one of the people on that that team.
Yeah, we used to be here under Hubby and also Hansen.
Hubby was the president while I was a student, and then Hansen was the president when I started working here.
Right, and then Dr. Baring and Dr. Jeske. So you've been under several presidents. Someone asked me that the other day, and I said, "Well, that's a little bit more than that." Okay. Were you ever involved with any of that, the historically Black institution visitation program? Were you ever?
I would be there just representing engineering.
Okay.
Only for the luncheons, nothing spectacular.
Did any of the, did you make any contacts at all? I mean, did some of the students that were there, did you make any contacts?
Oh, some of them actually came to school here, but the faculty were more involved with the visitation program, and that's what it should have been, because they were coming from graduate school.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't know anything about graduate school, and I didn't do any graduate school recruiting. And so the faculty was more involved in that. Dean Huggins and Dean, the associate dean before Dean Huggins. I can't remember his name. That's terrible because I used to, Dr. McLaughlin. They were more involved with directing that and getting the faculty involved with that. So that was not
a But it's an ongoing program because it's still in its existence.
Right.
One of the things that you people have, remember you have that job fair every February.
The National Society of Black Engineers, yes.
In conjunction with the... with Engineers Week, too. And that, you all work together on that. And that's been very, very successful. And as you know, we've gone to quite a few of them.
Right.
Very, very nice. I think they've done an excellent program. This year, I think they had on a Saturday. It usually used to be on Sunday.
Well, they just started that stuff this last 2 years. I don't know what's going on. I haven't been to it for a couple of years.
Uh-huh. But they used to have it. They used to have the dinner on Sunday evening, and then, but it was very nice. Any other awards? Tell us about how you got that Beverly Stone Award. Any other awards you got? If you'd like to share some.
I used to get the best teacher award. I must have gotten that probably 5 or 6 times in freshman engineering. And then when Phil Wonkott came, after a while, he just said, you know, we got to change the rules. Because he needed his young faculty that needed to get tenured to get the award. And I'm saying, well, you know, I didn't make the rules. And the students, you know, they did the voting. And a couple of times I got the best teacher award and the best counselor award, both. And then finally, I got the Beverly Stone Award. I can't remember when I got that. What kind of
1982 excellence in non-academic counseling, Omicron Delta Kappa Honor Service.
Okay, see, I think that came from another area within the university.
Sure.
But I got it, which was really nice because Dean Stone was the dean when I was a student, and I was one of the people that helped founded our chapter of our sorority here at Purdue University, Delta Sigma Theta. And I used to go and meet with her to try to get us a chapter of this black sorority on campus. And so she was the dean at that time. And then when I graduated and left here for 2 years, but then we came back in 1971 or 72, I applied for a job in the Dean of Students office after I completed my master's in, or the Dean of Women's office. Mm-hmm. And they said they didn't have any openings. And so as a joke, between a friend of mine and myself, I applied for an opening in the Dean of Men's office, and in fact, I got that job, which blew everybody away. So about a year after that...
You were the only woman in there, right?
Right, except for a graduate student they had also brought on at that time. And so I was the first full-time female that ever worked in the Dean of Men, first and only full-time female that ever worked in the Dean of Men's office at Purdue University. Because in my second year, the two offices merged into the Dean of Students office. So I was there a year for the Dean of Students office, and then that's when the people over in engineering came and started talking to me about coming and taking this new job they were creating for the minority engineering effort. And I finally broke down and went over there and took that job. but anyway, the Dean Stone Award, and that came from a separate area within the university. But the best teacher and the best counselor awards...
Did you get the A.A. Potter?
I got A.A. Potter, yes.
Wonderful.
And that year, that was the first year they had 3 people from engineering get it. I guess they said a non-engineering black female is not going to get the A.A. Potter Award by herself. So myself and 2 other faculty members split the A.A. Potter Award that year that I got it. But that was because I had been the best teacher of the year thing, and it got advanced to that particular round of competition and was able to get it. And the interesting thing was is that I was just finally recuperating from having had major surgery. I had a malignant tumor on my only kidney, and I had just gotten through and could finally get out. That was probably the first place I went that I could go anywhere, was to get the A.A. Potter Award. It was interesting that President Buering actually asked me how I was doing. He had been concerned about my health.
So. Do you have some contacts with Dr. Barry?
Not even
not so much.
In fact, we did not have a great relationship when he first started. He used to really do some really dumb stuff and say some really dumb things. And the one time that someone carved some really awful stuff on a director of science, the minority director of science program's door, and somebody had slashed some tires, he made some awful comment, and I was so outraged. I wrote him a very, very, very long letter. And I feel bad now because when I go back, I said, this is just way too long. But evidently, he had wanted to talk to me, and I just said, I don't have anything else to say. I mean, I said it all in that letter. Dr. Yang was trying to get me to have a conversation with him, and I just said, I just don't think that's necessary. And then later on, we started to have interaction, and it was positive.
Did you meet Dr. Jeske? Did you ever meet him?
Yeah, I did. He invited Cornell Bell and I to have lunch with him one time in his earlier years. He wanted to know why everywhere he went, our names were always mentioned. And he wanted to know what it was we did. And I just told him, I do unto others as I have them do unto me. The golden rule, I was taught that. I don't think he liked that answer.
did, you, you and Dr. Bell work at all on any projects together or not?
Not really. In fact,
was he here before you came?
Oh, he was here working before I came. Oh, he wasn't here as when I was an undergraduate. He came, I believe, after I left as a faculty person. I didn't know him before that. But he used to do some really awful stuff, and it used to make Dean Hancock really angry. Because I would have recruited kids, you know, and they'd be would have applied for admissions to the schools of engineering, and then all of a sudden they changed their interest and go into business. It was because Cornell would go and tell these kids there was no difference between industrial engineering and industrial management. And then the kids would be so mad after they got here. And they couldn't get into engineering because engineering had gotten so tight at the time. And they realized that they had been sold a bill of goods. Yes. And they would be so angry with him. But then he was responsible for graduating quite a large number of students as well. And they'd done very well financially in their businesses. So some of them own their own businesses a whole bit. And we've got students that own their own businesses that are CEOs of things and all kinds of stuff. So I think that Cornell and I think we did quite a bit too.
He was here for a long period of time. In fact, that one time we saw him, I guess he had open heart surgery.
I don't know about open heart, but
it was bypass or something. Maybe it was bypass, because he mentioned that he'd have that, because he was telling Jim about that.
He kind of fell apart after his wife died. That just destroyed him. Huh. And then one day he came to work and he ran into something in the garage and he was in the hospital for quite a long time.
Anything that I didn't ask that you'd like to share with us that, in retrospect, or...
Well, I don't know if this is true, but I'm beginning to think that I may hold the record as the longest tenured African-American professional on this campus. I think it was going to be between me and Cornell, but he's retired now and I'm still hanging in there. So I'm not sure if that's true or not. I'd like to find that out, but I think it is.
That's very good.
It's been an interesting journey. I've loved it, and I've hated it, and right now I don't like it. I've seen so many changes. I've watched things that many of us, including Barry and some of the other faculty, have built up over the years that were so good, and I just watch it falling apart in front of our faces, and it just makes me just sick inside. And I know we were doing good things because we made good things happen to other people. I think that a lot of things that were traditional about Purdue that shouldn't have been touched got touched under the Jiskie regime, and I really hate that. That was kind of what was so unique about Purdue. You know, there were some things that was just straight Purdue. Nobody can ever match it, and now I just feel like we're a commercial body. Yeah, I hate that. I really hate that.
There's always changes that go on.
Change is good, but all change is not necessary. Okay, some things you just don't touch, you know? You just don't touch them. And why people don't understand that, I don't understand. Other than the fact that they want to have streets named after them and buildings named after them. It's just a shame.
Yeah. How much longer are you going to be on halftime? Are you going
to be... Well, actually, I'm on 95%, presumably. But after what happened with the summer programs, I'm not sure I can do it anymore. This is really bad this summer. The things that happened that caused...
To make some real life.
Just, the kids were great. I had a couple of bad apples, but you know, that's normal. But the adults really showed out this year, and I just don't think I want to go through that again. I'm not going to be disrespecting like that.
One thing I was going to ask you, on the groups that you had over the years, have you had some from the same families at times?
Students?
Students.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, so none of the younger, the older might come. Well, that's very good.
Yeah. Like I said, it was a systemic approach, and... I really did treat these children like they were part of my family, and that's what a lot of parents appreciated, the fact that I was firm. I didn't take a lot of gaff off of anybody. And like Jane Daniels and some of the others would say, oh, but you're so hard on her. I said, you know what? I'm trying to make sure that this child is successful. You do your students that you work with the way you want to, but these children actually appreciate it when I'm hard on them, because then they succeed, and then their parents come back, and they're really glad. So you do what you want to do with the ones you're working with, and I'm going to do this the way I know it's going to work for me. And they always come back, and they're very appreciative of it. And they come back now and tell their kids, you really don't want to make her mad when they come to the summer program.
Yeah.
I had one this summer, the couple, the little boy was also playing in some kind of playoffs for baseball, and the wife was one of my former students, and she had told the kid and the husband, I'm not messing with it. I'm not going to ask her to let him leave early to go and do this. Now, you want to do that? You're on your own. I'm not doing that, because she knew I was going to just raise all kinds of stuff. And I ended up letting him go, because the father swore he'd bring him right back that same night, each time he'd have to go up there. But she walked away. She said, I don't have anything to do with it. I'm leaving, because I know how she is, and I'm not going to mess with it, period.
Anything else you want to share with us?
Yeah.
I really appreciate this. It's been, you really added a lot to...